National anthem.
भारत भाग्य विधाता पंजाब सिंध गुजरात मराठा द्राविड़ उत्कल बंग विंध्य हिमाचल यमुना गंगा उज्ज्वल जलधि तरंग तव शुभ नामे जागे तव शुभ आशीष मागे गाहे तव जय गाथा जन गण मंगलदायक जय है भारत भाग्य विधाता जय है जय है जय है जय 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 है
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. A very hearty welcome to the National Business Convention 2016, organized by Balaji Institute of Modern Management on the theme Emerging Challenges in the Business Environment, where we embark upon a journey in our quest for knowledge, new learnings, and hearing the experiences of the stalwarts.
The National Business Convention is being conducted over a period of 3 days, that is, the 29th, 30th, and 31st of July 2016, where business moguls from the sectors of marketing, finance, HR, to name a few, would come and share their experiences and insights, giving the students a chance to go deeper on the emerging business challenges and to help create solutions rather than just talk about problems.
For today's morning session, I, Kumar Gaurav,
and I, Anuja Karandikar,
are proud and privileged to be your masters of ceremony. We always march forward, opening doors to new arenas because we are curious and that leads us to explore innovative solutions to problems.
Let us begin marching ahead to enlighten ourselves by the ray of knowledge from the corporate leaders that we have amongst us today by lighting the felicitous lamp. I request our esteemed chief guest, Mr. S. Venkatesh, guest of honor, Mr. Sunil Kashikar, our beloved Bala sir, and other dignitaries to light the lamp.
LHR, the Learning R Record. Sri Balaji Society prepares its students with rigorous training for hours together to meet the challenging requirements of the corporate, and maintaining 100% attendance throughout is an achievement in itself. There are some outstanding students who have emerged as achievers by not missing a single day of college. And it's time we recognize this extraordinary feat. I now request Dr. Dimple Saini, Director, Corporate Relations, Sri Balaji Society, to announce the names of the 100% LHR achievers. I would request our chief guest, Mr. S. Venkatesh, to hand over the awards.
Very good morning to all of you. Okay, I have great pleasure in announcing the names of these students who've got 100% LHR, not a single lecture missed. So can you put your hands together? Can I have a big round of applause for Miss Ria Shanmukhani? Ria. And can I request our chief guest, Mr. Venkatesh, kindly hand over a certificate? Harshita Gupta. Can we put our hands together for Kanisha Bansal, BIB, 100% LHR. Can I have a huge round of applause, please? And from BIMM HRD, Mr. Abhishek Kumar Saha. A huge round of applause. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, sir.
Sri Balaji Society derives its essence from the four centers of knowledge. Balaji Institute of Modern Management, BIMM.
Balaji Institute of Telecom and Management, BITM.
Balaji Institute of International Business, BIIB.
Balaji Institute of Management and Human Resource Development, BIMHRD.
Which have stood the tests of time, imbibing each of its students discipline, dedication, and determination, values for life.
Now, I call upon student manager Apurva Tiwari to deliver the welcome address.
Good morning, one and all present here. I, Apurva Tiwari, representing the senior batch 2015-17 of Sri Balaji Society, feels immensely delighted to extend a very warm welcome to our chief guest, Mr. S. Venkatesh, guest of honor, Mr. Sunil Kashikar, our beloved Bala sir, directors, other dignitaries, faculty members, and our dear student managers. Knowledge is a treasure, but practice is the key to it. Today, we have the opportunity of interacting and gaining insights from unparalleled corporate stalwarts who hold both the treasure and the key. Welcome to the National Business Seminar 2016. In this VUCA business world, driven by challenging economies, quality, and technology, challenges are being coined as interventions of change for being bigger and better. What are these challenges? How do our business leaders brace themselves to create success stories and their expectations from the younger generation of managers would be the core of our seminar. Since the pursuit of knowledge has a beginning but not an end, let us commence on this journey to quench our thirst for learning. I hope this session would be valuable learning experience with takeaways that each one of us would imbibe on our path of being corporate citizens. Thank you.
Thank you, Apurva. May I now request Dr. Archana Srivastav, Director, Balaji Institute of Modern Management, to address the audience.
Good morning, our esteemed chief guest, Mr. S. Venkatesh, President HR RPG Group, our guest of honor, Mr. Sunil Kashikar, VP Resource Management, Zensar Technologies, respected Bala sir, and dignitaries on and off the dais, and dear student managers, a very good morning to all of you. It gives me immense pleasure to welcome you all to the National Seminar 2016, organized by Balaji Institute of Modern Management. This convention, spanning over the next 3 days, is a conference of great minds from the corporate world. Eminent thought leaders from the industry will share their experiences and insights on the theme for the conference, that is, emerging challenges in the business environment. In the 21st century, the world is groping with a new normal, a business environment that is volatile, uncertain, complex, and ambiguous, or as best described by the acronym VUCA. The only thing permanent is change. Today, companies face, I can only promise, a great learning experience in this conference where thought-provoking and soul-searching issues will be shared by the industry stalwarts. Make the most of it.
Thank you, ma'am. May I request Bala sir, Founder President, Sri Balaji Society, Executive Director, Balaji Institute of Modern Management, to address this August gathering.
Friends, perhaps the first time I am giving a talk by sitting like this. I am 70 plus. I always believe in standing, but then somewhere something happened. Health problem. So forgive me first. So I am here to welcome our chief guest and our guest of honor and to thank on behalf of all of you, on behalf of Sri Balaji Society, the managing trustees, the faculties, the staff and every one of them for sparing their valuable time to be with us today, sir. We are here to learn from you, sir. My students are very keen to know your thoughts on this. These budding managers are about to enter the industry in a year time, and they have been groomed and shaped very well. Once again, thank you very much, sir, Venkatesh sir, and sir, for sparing this occasion, for coming for all the way for us. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Today, businesses face a range of challenges. As business grows, different problems demand different solutions, and these breakthrough solutions come up only when one is well-versed in adapting to this dynamic business environment. The need of the hour demands one to keep oneself abreast with the latest developments given the current scenario.
And Sri Balaji Society has always believed in giving its students a 360-degree view of the corporate by bringing in the best of faculties and keeping regular interactions with the corporate leaders, helping us to brace and equip ourselves with every tool to face challenges and convert them to opportunities.
Ladies and gentlemen, we have amongst us Mr. S. Venkatesh, President HR, RPG Group, as our chief guest, and Mr. Sunil Kashikar, VP, Resource Management Group, Zensar Technologies, as our guest of honor. We are privileged to have them grace us with their presence.
I would like to request Dr. Professor D.S. Kadam, Director, Projects and Alumni, to welcome our chief guest with a bouquet. Now, I would like to request Professor Biju Pillai, Director IT, to welcome our guest of honor with a bouquet.
Now I would like to request student manager Surbhi Kamle to introduce our guest.
Thank you, Anuja. First of all, a very warm good morning to one and all present here. I, Surbhi Kamle, takes immense pleasure to introduce our guest of honor, Mr. S. Venkatesh, President Group HR and Management Board Member, RPG Group. Sir has acquired his Master's in Personnel Management and Industrial Relations from Tata Institute of Social Science. He holds a Senior HR Director profile with close to 29 years of experience across MNCs, diversified Indian business groups, private equity, and consulting. Since 1996, he has been holding leadership positions at the national level for very large operations. He has worked with several conglomerates like ITC Limited, Vedanta Resources, BPL, and Arvind Limited. Sir, we welcome you to this convention from the bottom of our hearts. I request you to please address our audience. The podium is all yours. Thank you so much, sir.
Good morning, everybody.
Morning, sir.
I'd like to start off by saying thank you to Bala sir, who I've known over the last maybe 10 years, for almost two decades. And you know, thank you for the kind courtesy extended and having me over here. I'm really privileged to be here, and it feels nice to be here after so many years in your new campus. So thank you, Bala sir. And faculty members, officials, executives of Balaji Society, my colleague Sunil Kashikar, and dear students, the reason why all of us are here today, I also say good morning to you and my best wishes in advance. What you're going to see now is really some kind of distilled common sense that we have all acquired over the years. As things become more and more complex, we also realize that things continue to remain the same. Some of the principles of the way we manage business, the way we manage people and organizations haven't really dramatically changed in the last 25, 30 years. The world is indeed becoming complex, and therefore, some of the strategies and some of the tactics that we need to adopt have changed gradually over the years. But the core value systems that we need to have, the kind of principles that we need to keep are still the same. Those haven't fundamentally altered. So I appreciate that we have a very diverse set of people here, including students from various disciplines. I'm going to be making a very generic presentation, but I will pepper it with a lot of illustrations, a lot of personal learnings that we've all learned, not exactly almost all the time in the most pleasant ways. We have learned, it was also baptism through fire most of the time. So I would like my presentation to be fairly interactive. So I would, if you wish, I don't know what is the structure that all of you have, but either I can run through the presentation and then we can have some time for Q&A, or you can stop me and ask me. If you have any questions, please stop me. Okay, so I think let's look at where we are today. Let's look at the macroeconomic environment. Let's look at what are the challenges which are facing us today. Now, costs, increasingly the world is realizing that, the endless boom days are over. In 2008, when the Lehman crash happened, the world fundamentally altered. Since then, the world has been on a bit of a downward plunge. There have been some sectors which have actually gained or grown. For example, we never had e-commerce in let's say, 7-8 years back, and that's a new kind of a business which is making inroads. But generally, costs have become very, very important. The global commodity market has crashed in the last 3 years. And it's very interesting what people say, that when a country conducts its Olympics, there is a boom period. And if you remember, the 10-year commodity climb up ended with the end of the Beijing Olympics. And then, of course, the subprime crisis happened, the Lehman and the financial markets crash happened in 2008. And then the world has been on a downward plunge. every company is wanting to create a specific USP competitive edge in terms of why it exists and why customers should come to it for either its products or services. You know, there is so much of clutter today. If you open, you know, the papers, there are, you know, n number of mobile phones, there are n number of e-commerce service providers. Why should they choose your company? Why should they choose your organization? So I think it's becoming very, very important to define what your offerings are and what you mean to the marketplace. So demand, you know, what we used to think, there used to be unlimited demand, for example, in the days of, you know, license and permitrage. You know, the demand was controlled and therefore the demand was artificially high. You had to wait for 6 years to get a scooter from Bajaj. I remember when we were young, people used to proudly claim my father brought home a Bajaj scooter. And sometimes you had to pay in foreign exchange to get that Bajaj scooter. And you had to wait for years to get a telephone connection. So now from that artificial demand control situation, we've come into completely free market. But in a free market, there is so much of competition and so many people offering the same set of products and services that you can't take demand for granted anymore. I think people are becoming extremely demanding. People are becoming extremely irreverent. The great brands of yesteryears are being challenged. And all of you have learned in your own management textbooks some of the great brands like Kodak and all of them which have taken a nosedive over the years because either they didn't keep pace with technology or they didn't see customer demand and customer expectations changing dramatically. And customer loyalty, I think, you know, it's going to be very difficult to say that, look, this 40 million people will forever be Coke customers or Pepsi customers. It's not. For the first time, aerated beverages have not grown all over the world. And the top five, you know, beverages in the world are all healthier alternatives because people are moving away from, you know, carbonated drinks to more healthier alternatives. Technology, of course, you know, and you'll hear my colleague Sunil talking more about that because he's a greater expert than I am to talk about technology. But technology is fundamentally altering every sector. And, you know, we used to think that there are some sectors which are going to be less affected by technology, but I think the impact of technology is, you know, wide-ranging. It doesn't spare any particular business or organization. Now, this is a very, very important kind of a development. You know, increasingly with free market, you're also seeing a huge amount of regulatory requirements that we need to fulfill. Every sector is now slowly moving towards establishing a regulator. So it is a bit of a contradiction that while we have a free market, there is also an ombudsman, there is a regulator who's actually monitoring and ensuring. Telecom started it a long time back. Insurance has a regulator. Pension has a regulator. And slowly every sector, we don't have a real estate regulator, which is probably the one which is most required in this country. But I think the government is increasingly making plans to introduce it. So anywhere in the world that you go, you have to, I wouldn't use the word manage, which has got negative connotations. You've got to be compliant. You've got to understand the regulatory requirements. Particularly financial services companies are kind of pretty complex to manage today. Probably some of the other sectors are less so, but finance, pensions, insurance, all the whole BFSI segment companies are finding it extremely difficult to manage the regulatory differences between countries. And governance, which is actually your own regulatory mechanism within the company. And, you know, companies which thought that they can grow at breakneck speed without bothering about governance and regulatory have all either crashed or have slowed down. So I always say that ever since 2008, companies have to manage three kinds of risks. So there is a regulatory risk, there is a governance risk, and there is a talent risk. You know, companies which thought that they were talent magnets are realizing that they're no longer talent magnets, and companies which took talent and people for granted are realizing that, look, if they only had focused on building a talent pipeline, on creating a great culture, instead of just worrying about physical assets, have actually prospered. And there are multiple examples in the market. Some of those names I can't take today. But you'll see around you some of the greatest companies are struggling because they haven't focused on the talent piece. Now, so what are the, how do you actually maintain a competitive edge. So now you have the option of focusing on a business which only constantly provides innovative products. Okay. Now, is that something which all of us can afford to do, or have the capacity or the competency to do? You'll have to question, how is your company structured, and does it have the wherewithal to kind of constantly be innovative? Or it has to be differentiated. It has to be differentiated that you need not follow the same beaten track. You're providing another kind of experience in terms of product experience and service experience to your customers. So that is clearly another way of kind of maintaining that competitive edge. Monitor the competition. A lot of companies start taking the competition for granted. I can take names like the old Unilever, Hindustan Lever, Nirma battle, where, you know, the David and the Goliath kind of competition happened, and the competition was taken for granted for many years. But today, no major company takes any small competition very, very lightly, because everybody knows that the equations can dramatically change. And also, how do we predict future trends? Companies which are able to see what is happening at a societal level, at a larger economic level, are able to fine-tune internal processes, internal innovative systems to come out with products and services which are, let's say, far more future-ready. And maintaining relationships. What happens is that when companies grow to a certain size, they believe that the earlier stakeholders are no longer important, and they start focusing either on a completely new set of stakeholders, whether it is the supplier universe or whether it is the customer universe, which is far more lethal to play around with. But great companies are focused on maintaining relationships with all the key stakeholders. And how do you get into a situation where you're constantly gaining market and customer loyalty? One is build this into the business strategy. Most of the time, customer loyalty and ensuring that, you know, the market share is maintained is seen as a sales and marketing requirement, but it is not baked into the larger business strategy and the larger business plan. It doesn't become the CEO's responsibility. Loyalty schemes and developing the brand are, of course, fairly no-brainer ways of maintaining it, but it is important that those kind of interventions never lose value. But our most important challenge, and I say this at the cost of repetition, is your whole talent strategy. And companies which have taken it lightly have paid the price. So if you look at the last 70, 80 years of corporate life in India, and if you look at the companies which have lasted the 70, 80 years, you know, which are the companies which come to your mind? You think of companies, a lot of the companies came from the FMCG world. You know, you had great companies like Unilever, Procter & Gamble, and of course, industrial conglomerates like General Electric. They've all been there for close to 100 years, more than 100 years. And all the things that I spoke about in the previous slides, they have continued to kind of build upon. And they have kind of reinvented themselves with each passing generation of business challenges. So I think it's going to be very important to also note that these companies that I'm talking about had a very, very strong cultural kind of a mooring. You know, they ensured that their culture was unique. They had the right environment in which talent came, could be innovative, could ask questions, could actually, take challenges. For example, I remember my first company, ITC. I was all of 28 years old when they decided to head of North India and our largest factory, which was in a place called Saharanpur. And then those days, in 1992, it was a 900 crore business. You know, I really wonder, how did the company take that bet? Now, I could have made many mistakes, and I indeed made many mistakes. But it was about you learning from the mistakes and the company letting you learn from the mistakes. So I think the kind of talent strategy and the overarching principles that you want to build in your company is going to be a very, very key factor for maintaining your competitive advantage. And just look at some of the headlines which are grabbing eyeballs today. And I wanted to tell you about, you know, first of all, if you look at the e-commerce world, you know, suddenly 2 years back, when we were all looking for leadership talent from various companies for various roles within, let's say, even RPG Group, we were told that, look, none of them want to join traditional conglomerates anymore. And they've all gone to the Flipkarts and the Snapdeals and the Amazons of the world. So it is once in 10 years you have a fundamental disruption in the talent market like this. And e-commerce, for example, is grabbing talent. They have, you know, reached a level where they are also facing certain headwinds. But at the end of the day, it is there to kind of redefine the way we sell products and services. At the same time, and I deliberately put this slide after the previous slide, is that a lot of people are joining, and probably it is a set of people who are from a different generation, but they're realizing that everything is not hunky-dory when you join a disruptor. You know, there is great energy, and there is great amount of anticipation to build up a new business, but there is also a lack of any defined culture, because it won't happen. When you join a startup, when you join a new emerging business, you know, culture, organization, ethos, all of that gets built over time, and you can't fast track it, okay? So there are some people who feel, you know, I can't take the chaos, I can't take the, you know, the disruptive energy, and I can't take the 15-hour work days, and therefore they come back to another sector. So that is also happening. It's important because, you know, on one hand, people are getting attracted to the sector. On the other hand, there are people moving away from this sector. Now, when we go to B schools, and there are a number of B school graduates whom we are meeting, who are saying, you know, I know that you are a great company, and I also come from a great institute, but I don't see myself working for somebody. So they want to become entrepreneurs from day one. And some of them, of course, have worked in the past, maybe after their engineering degree, before they got onto their MBAs. So the whole entrepreneurial ecosystem is thriving, is bubbling. And sometimes I wish, you know, 25, 30 years back when we were all passing out of college, this kind of opportunity existed. A, it was not socially acceptable. You know, my father would have really, you know, wondered what's wrong with me if I told him I'm not going to join ITC, but I'm going to do a startup. But today this is indeed a reality, and it's good news for India. Because, you know, you cannot have so many business graduates, so many engineering graduates being absorbed by the same set of, you know, I don't know how many companies, 1,000 corporates, which cannot expand at the rate at which our population is growing and the amount of talent which is coming into the market every day. And we hear about this, right? We hear about engineering colleges, and I'm told, for example, in Tamil Nadu, there are more engineering college seats than engineering students available to get into college. So they are now running a campaign to attract students from all over the country to fill up those seats. And this is a phenomenon in many states which have really went berserk in terms of starting engineering colleges. And it's the same with MBA students, right? Barring institutes which are focused on quality, which are focused on a certain regimen, there are so many management graduates who are literally struggling to find any job, forget about their dream job. Employee costs. Now, we live in a market like India where a lot of you from HR will start managing people's expectations when you enter this function. And you find that the expectation on, for example, getting increment is very high. In the entire Asia-Pacific market, Hewitt and Mercer keep telling us the highest increment rate for the last 15 years has been India. Now, of course, our base is not as high as, let's say, a Japan or a South Korea or a Singapore or Hong Kong. But it's not low either. From the time all of us started off when, you know, our salaries were quite laughable, currently you have certain sectors which are facing the threat of no longer being viable because executive salaries are going through the roof. A lot of, for example, shared services companies, I know personally, are saying that, look, it's cheaper to nearshore than to now offshore in India. And I mean, that's a situation we couldn't have imagined 10 years back. For example, if you go into the Midwest, which is a large central portion of the US, costs are much cheaper. Of course, you don't have to be on the either coast of the US, which is either on the east or the west coast, which are far more expensive. So costs are increasing. Our profitability, our competitive edge is not necessarily increasing year after year. This is a reality. Increasingly in companies, we are going to see people like you. You're going to see less people like me and Sunil, which is a reality. And how do you manage this population? How do you manage this population? How do you manage their expectations? I think they are a great blend, and I think they are far more confident. When I say they, I mean you, all of you, right? All of you are far more confident, all of you are far more competent than what we were, let's say, 30 years back when we were passing out of our respective institutes. But what millennials want, and I use the word millennial in a broad way, I asked my son, who's about 22 years old, what is the meaning of millennial? He gave a interpretation which he said is almost over 15 years spread. So whichever it is certainly not our generation, it is certainly not maybe the next, it's maybe the third generation, especially people like you, young talent like you who are getting into the workforce. So this is going to be very important because, you know, there are multiple dynamics happening in this millennial market, okay? One is people are always, you know, mobile, they're wanting to go and do something more exciting than what they were doing yesterday. People want results, people want instant answers. They're not willing to wait for that answer for 10 years, you know? How do you get, you know, work fulfillment? If I'd asked that question, my boss would have told me, wait for 6 years. Once you've gained some experience, you'll realize. But I can't say that to the young millennials who are joining the workforce today. And of course, you know, people are looking for work-life balance. They are looking for something innovative and exciting to do. And most importantly, which I think is a great development for India, and more people that I meet like you are saying that, look, we want to work for companies which we are proud to kind of call our employers, correct? They are saying that, look, we don't want to work for companies whose value systems are not matching with ours. Is that correct? Is that what all of you think? Yeah. So gone are the days when, you know, people were, you know, the whole license permitraj era 25 years back limited the number of opportunities. It was either a few private sector corporates, it was public sector corporations, and of course government service, which was, you know, a million people applied for some 2,000 jobs or something. Now, in those days, people didn't have a choice of saying, oh, you know, and there is so much information available now in the public domain about every company, every promoter, every chairman, every set of CXOs, that people have already done their research. I guess all of you, when you go for your campus interviews, you've done your research already, right? In terms of what the outlook is for the business, who's the CEO, you've gone to Glassdoor, you've seen what are the reviews about the company. There are enough Facebook accounts to tell you which company is doing what, does it have a great culture. So everything is out in the open, companies are getting examined day after day. And I think it's very important for the leadership generation to realize that things are not the same anymore. So I think the whole emphasis today, which companies are focusing on, is how do you retain the right kind of talent? And if you notice, the magnet is not attracting everybody in the company, and companies are also not hesitant to say that, look, we will have our own culture filter, we will have a performance filter, but at the end of the day, we will decide the kind of people whom we want to retain and grow. Right? Engaging your workforce. And there are multiple things which you can use. For example, culture is a great engagement. It creates a lot of stickiness. Corporate reputation, ethical practices, I spoke about. Unique roles and autonomy. I think a lot of people are coming and saying, give us autonomy. Hold us accountable. Fire us if you want, but give us autonomy. Right? Top management vision. I think people are wanting to work for people who are great, inspiring leaders. You know, just because somebody has completed 25 years in the company and has reached the level of senior vice president or executive director, you're not going to automatically respect that person. Career growth and development, I think, you know, the career growth that, you know, 20 years back was thought of as just a, you know, step-by-step process of moving up the ladder. Today could be, you could move laterally, you could go up a winding staircase, but at the end of the day, you are learning new things and you're doing different things, more interesting things. So, you know, I think the word VUCA has been beaten to death, and it is going from VUCA to greater VUCA. I don't know what the new terminology is. But I think this is very simple, right? You just cannot, for your organization, you just cannot borrow best practices and try to retrofit them, okay? You got to create practices, processes, which adapt to your DNA. And I will tell you about why. So this is important because, you know, over the years I've thought about, you know, and of course I've worked with more than one company, and that helps you crystallize your thoughts about which are the kind of companies which exist in the market. What is your own DNA and what is the company's DNA and how do you fit the two together? If you really look at this, if you look at, I'm just giving you a sectoral spread. For example, this is pretty similar to the kind of businesses that we have in RPG Group itself. We have IT services, from where my colleague Sunil comes. We have pharma, we have a life sciences company. We have a plantation company. We have an infrastructure company. We don't have an hospitality company. We don't have an FMCG company. But we do have a part FMCG company, which is Sear Tires, which is both a B2B and a B2C company. But just giving you a spread of the kind of, and of course, there are many other sectors which I'm missing from this slide, okay? What is the kind of company that you want to be? And there are many people with different philosophies. And we want to be the biggest. Reliance Industries, $400,000. You can't get bigger than that, it's the biggest. They will want to be, I once met Mr. Ambani and he said that, look, we want to be a $1 trillion company. So that's a mind-boggling figure, right? And they believe that they can do it in not too many years. So this is one model, right? And all of you, when you go and look at the job market, when you want to, you know, and also later on, when you grow your careers, just be clear about what you want to do. And there is no one particular thought process or model which is right. Or I will be a long-term player, that I will outlast every downturn that happens in the market, but I will be, maybe I'll grow at industry level CAGR, but I will outlast the competition and survive. So that is another philosophy, you know. It's not necessarily a bad philosophy. And I want to be an admired and respected company. Come what may, you know, I do not want to compromise on my ethics. Now, I had the privilege of, during my entrepreneurial days, I was a consultant to the TVS group. And I worked with them for 4 years. And, you know, I was initially wondering how they are able to maintain that sterling reputation of theirs. They are so amazing that nobody in the company, and I've usually heard union leaders say something disparaging or negative about the management, but I used to spend a lot of time with the union. They always said that, look, whatever we can say about the company, it's beyond ethical. And right from the chairman downwards, everybody practices this in their daily life. So this is another model. And all of you have to decide where you want to be. You want to work for a $100 billion company? You want to work for a long-term player? Do you want to work for the most admired and respected company? Of course, you want everything. Just be a little practical that it doesn't happen in the real world, right? And also look at some of the traits which companies display, and they wear it, you know, very proudly on their, you know, sleeves, saying that this is what defines us. One of the most innovative companies in the world, and very few can, you know, stake claim to that, is Google, very innovative, right? Brand power. You know, most consumer companies work on this, that they say the brand is like a walking, talking manifestation of who we are as a company. And therefore, and all brands, you know, we've forgotten that there are also other great brands like Surf, like Dettol, a lot of consumer products that we take for granted today, Colgate, are all great brands which have lived with us, right? But the power of the brand carries them through. And of course, corporate citizenship. You know, we want to be the most admired, respected, right? Tatas. I've been there for more than 150 years. Before the Factories Act was enacted, before the Trade Union Act was enacted, you know, the founders of Tata, Jamshedji Tata, introduced all of this in Jamshedpur, okay? And in fact, the model code of many of these acts was actually modeled on what Jamshedpur practiced. And so this is a great institution which has continued to inspire Indians generation after generation. And of course, cost leadership, it's another acceptable model, right? And I'm sure there are now a lot of companies under that. It's not just Cro-Max. All the phones that we buy, clear cost leadership. I want to penetrate the market, grab 20%. So this is clearly a strategy. So, and if you look at what organizations are and look at the challenges, I always found that if you cut through all the big major complex discussions that we are having, it finally boils down to two important pieces of the jigsaw puzzle. One is organization. And an organization, it's not a simple, it's not a simple kind of a thing. You're talking about structure. How are you structured? You're talking about headcount, which decides your cost effectiveness and your agility. Technology, agility of course is here. Culture, stretch, and talent on demand. I mean, it's not just permanent headcount. There is an increasing movement towards what I call the flexible workforce or talent on demand. And the other part of the jigsaw puzzle is, of course, performance, the way you manage performance. Okay, so there is the whole raft of processes that I'm sure those of you who are specializing in HR are learning about, which is about, you know, how do you reward people, talent management, what are the measures? And of course, you know, don't look at performance management as only internal. How do stakeholders get their returns? How is the business measured? And therefore, do all stakeholders get to gain in the process? That's it. I didn't want to take too much more of your time. And of course, you know, we have the great quote here. And this is another enduring giant. I mean, as I discover more and more management thinkers, and I keep thinking how fascinating that Mr. Drucker has kind of seen the future many years back and has managed to find answers to most of them even before the issues cropped up. So I think I'm trying to be a little disciplined in terms of time. So I was told about maybe 30 to 35 minutes of presentation. And is it okay to take question and answer, Bala sir?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. So I would like this to be more interactive if possible, and you know, we can share some of our experiential learning, and maybe we should tell you what you shouldn't be doing based on our own experiences. So that's another way of sharing. So feel free to ask me questions, anybody, except one at a time, please. Yeah? Oh, okay, somebody's got a mic there. Yeah.
So this is Surbhi Bhargav from BIMM.
Yes.
So my question is regarding startups. Recently, okay, there's a trend in India, like many of the startups are closing. So according to you, what is the reason behind, like where they are lacking behind, which leads them to the closing of the industry?
Well, I had an opportunity to see startups at very close quarters. For 4 years, I was running my own HR services company, and I was doing a job which I found interesting. I was advising organizations on HR strategy on the fund side. So I worked with a lot of private equity funds. These are the guys who decide the fate of a lot of the startups. I think it's very simple. I think what most entrepreneurs should be doing is to establish the business model, what they call the proof of concept, right? So if the business model is established, then you go to the next step of finding the right people, finding the right funding and so on and so forth. I think some of these companies have started imagining that the business model is already robust. Maybe it hasn't been established. I'm just trying to think of a few possible reasons why they're doing. And also because I think they burnt cash too easily. A lot of funding is chasing fewer entrepreneurs, but the financial discipline of being very, very careful. But that's why, you know, that slide which is about e-commerce is showing salaries being offered which are disproportionate to the kind of stage at which they are. They just cannot afford to throw away that kind of money. By the way, all of us are actually buying goods online at the cost of private equity players. You know, the business model, the cost structure of the organization is not deciding the price at which you're buying today. It is an external factor, which is the investor money, which is deciding. So I think it is either business model not being established, cost being burnt too easily. Maybe it is also due to founder and promoter disharmony. I've seen that at very close quarters. A lot of them, learned that, look, while they were great friends in college, but they are not exactly able to work together in a startup team. So it's a multiplicity of factors. Yes.
Thanks, sir. My name is Kritachi Shastri. I'm pursuing PM in HR from BIMM HRD. My question to you goes in three parts. Recently, it has been in news that management graduates will be hired for around 10,000 per month as a pay. So do you think that if these people, like you mentioned in your slides, that they are moving towards startups and their own entrepreneurship. So do you think that it's kind of a deliberate attempt to promote startups, or because the graduates are not getting paid, well paid by the organizations, they're moving towards startups?
I think those who have this entrepreneurial streak are very clear that they want to do it. It's even there are people who are walking away from great offers and wanting to do something on their own. I think that is the real group of entrepreneurs. And those who are moving into startups because you are not getting anything else, well, that's possible, but your heart will not be in it, right? You will always want to come back to a corporate job. So I do find a lot of people who are struggling to find a job after their MBA, but maybe the answer there is try to work for a smaller company, a good set of people to work with. It could be a 100, 200 crore company, doesn't matter. You don't have to work for always for a GE or a Unilever or an IBM. Work for a smaller company if you believe in the CEO's vision and you believe that you're making products, you are an ethical organization, it's a great culture. Please join and work for it. I know there will be financial pressures. You are paid a lot of money to get through college and all of that. But it's better than choosing a completely different sector wrongly because you don't have enough opportunities. You know. So there are opportunities galore in this market if you decide to step down from the big brands. I worked a lot with the small and medium enterprises myself, and there are a lot of good entrepreneurs in that sector who want to take their company to the next level. Okay? They've inherited their businesses from their fathers. They're at the threshold of growth, and what I call the sub 500 crore revenue sector is growing. It's growing. And if you look at great industrialized developed economies like Germany or US or even Japan, the backbone of the economy is these kind of companies. It is not, if you take the US, the majority of the people, 80% of the people are employed in this kind of sector. They are not employed necessarily in the large corporations that we are familiar with. So I think, you know, India will also choose. I think we are under societal pressure. You know, we want to go and say that we want to work for, we are working for an IBM or a Deloitte or a Reliance. We don't like to announce that we work for a smaller company, but I think it will happen. And if you are going to have a large number of management graduates available, maybe for the SME sector, it is a blessing in disguise. They will get these ready-made resources at a lower cost. So it will happen.
There was a third part, that is the point that you mentioned that they'll hire them at a lower cost. So do you think that they'll be able to work to their 100% and give the best they can because they are being paid less?
So I think, yeah, I think you, all of us have a certain value about ourselves in terms of what we should be getting. Maybe I'm crossing over. What we should be getting. But if the market reality is that you don't get that number, I think if you are a management professional, I will still say that, look, give your best. Work in the company. Learn skills. Economy will look up again. People will think well of you if you work for those 2 years with a lot of dedication, if you put a lot of energy into it. You'll get a better job. The company may expand, and the opportunity to be a leader that you probably may have got after 6 years in a larger company, you may get it after 2 years. I know an executive in a large infrastructure company who told me the same thing. He said, look, at that time I had the opportunity to go to Tata's and Mahindra's and very large groups. But he said, I chose this small infrastructure company because the promoter was a PhD. He was an MTech and a PhD who had returned back from the US. And he said, look, I want to create an ethical infrastructure company, which in those days seemed like an oxymoron. And he grew the company. From 40 crores, he grew it to about 500 crores. And this person became his chief operating officer in 4 years. So where will you get that kind of opportunity in a large company? So you can grow your career in multiple ways. You just have to be, you know, comfortable in your own skin. Don't come under peer pressure. Don't come under societal pressure. Do what is right. Work hard. You'll get the benefits.
Good morning, sir. Over here, on your right. Yeah.
Okay.
My name is Pooja Rawal. I am from BIMM Finance Specialization.
Yeah.
You talked about the most important challenge being finding and retaining best talent. So I would like to tell you that I came across an article related to talent acquisition on through social media websites on RPG Group website. So I would like to ask you that how far does these social media websites like FB, Twitter, and LinkedIn affect the recruitment of job seekers? And also, expressing your views on these websites, how far would they affect our recruitment or any individual's recruitment in the further
good,
process?
Very good question. And we also thought deep about what we should look for. So we have a social media reference check or an analysis. And we do it particularly for leadership candidates. I'm not sure if we do it down the line because we hire so many people. For example, Sunil's organization hires thousands of people every day, and I don't know. But I certainly do it. And we look for two or three things. One is we do our reference checks. We speak to a few people who have been their bosses and peers and so on and so forth. But that's one part. The other is how is the person, you know, sometimes when you just do a simple Google search, you can pick up issues, facts about that person. You know, for example, once we were hiring somebody and I just put X bad news and it came out that he was involved in a scandal in the company and he was fired. Now, none of the referees told me that because I think they wanted to be very correct and they didn't want to harm his career. And of course, when we look at people, we typically looked at what people put on LinkedIn because I think LinkedIn is an official professional website, right? I mean, it is like writing your resume. You can't just put anything there. And we have found sometimes gaps between what people have claimed on LinkedIn and what actually happened to them in their career. And that is an indication that the person is not being honest. And, you know, he or she is kind of trying to be, things can outsmart the organization. So we look for anything which, let's say, in the market is a known fact. It somehow has escaped our attention, like scandals, somebody being dismissed from his organization for sexual harassment, for example. So these are the things which we look for. We also look at how sometimes people conduct themselves. You know, there are ways and means you can conduct yourself. That, for example, if somebody is really running down their past employees by taking the names in print and talking, I mean, that's not looked upon well. You know, whatever you do, you should be courageous enough to have your conversation with that employer, and that's it, you close the chapter. You don't go about disparaging the organization forever in your public life because they don't do it to you. So it's not a nice indicator. It speaks about management maturity of that person and so on and so forth. So it is a filter at the last stage. I wouldn't say it is the only deciding factor. I will give some credence to it in addition to what we have. So be careful about what you write in social media, particularly about your professional life. About your personal life, you have a group of friends with whom you're sharing. That's none of our business. We are not interested in that.
Good morning, sir. This is Priya, towards your left. This is regarding your expansion policy, marketing question.
Sorry, what policy?
Expansion policy.
Expansion.
Recently I came across.
Okay.
You've partnered with Bio4 to enter into the US market, taking into consideration that Donald Trump is so eminently into the picture. What is driving you to, you know, enter into the US market so aggressively?
You are talking about a life sciences business?
Yes, sir.
Oh.
RPG Life Science
Group. Oh, yeah, yeah. No. Okay, so I think with or without Donald Trump, the US is a very critical market for us, right? And in the past, we've had partial success in US market. U.S. is a highly regulated pharma market, and you got to pass many stringent tests that they put. The U.S. FDA comes to our sites. Those of you who worked in pharma will understand that they actually carry very, very detailed inspection on your production sites to ensure it's all in line. So we've had some failures in the past, and we've had some successes. We have a new management team there. Our managing director used to be a director in GSK. We've hired very eminent chief quality officer who's done this. So we now have the confidence to go again into the US market. Right? The US is a very big market. You can't ignore US. And whether you're making branded products or generics, the US life sciences market is incredible. It's almost 60% of the global market.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Good morning, sir. This is Yogesh Kumar Barange from BIMM, Executive Batch Sales and Marketing.
Right.
My question is relating to the innovation part.
Yeah.
You mentioned, as manufacturing sector is struggling to maintain pace with service sector and growing e-commerce sector, how Gensur technology is coming innovative for their manufacturing sector clients and how they are helping them to like to push them more to the profit?
Oh, okay. Maybe you should reserve this question for Sunil when he comes. But So I don't entirely agree with you that manufacturing sector is struggling with innovation, because you're seeing a lot of innovation happening there. Okay. I can tell you, I'll give you our own examples. For example, in Seat Tires, we've established a state-of-the-art plant in Nagpur for two-wheeler manufacturing, which will be one of the largest two-wheeler tire manufacturing facilities in the world. And the entire factory is a smart factory. It's a digital factory. You know, so all the solutions that we are now taking to our customers in Zensar, which is IoT, the whole Internet of Things, is actually being practiced by us in the Seat Nagpur plant. I went and hired a chief digital officer for the company who was a TCS digital consultant. So on the earlier part of his life, he was advising his clients in terms of digital strategy and all of that. Now he's come on board and he's helping us implement some of those kind of advice and strategies he would have given to manufacturing. There's a lot of innovation happening, by the way. GE has, in this city, one of the four smart factories of the world where they've got the latest 3D technology, 3D printer technology available. So across all their product ranges, which I believe is about 300 or 400 product ranges, they can produce any product out of this factory. It's just amazing, and it's a very, very advanced factory. So there's a lot happening, by the way. There's a lot happening in packaging. There's a lot happening in aerospace. There's a lot happening in energy. So manufacturing sector is innovating, okay? And a lot of what we are trying to take to the customers in Zensar, for example, companies are already demanding those solutions, as Sunil will bear me out. It's not that, you know, they're completely blank about, you know, what digital can mean to them and all of that. In fact, we have within Zensar, we have a business called Digital Commerce, which is our e-commerce business, and it came from a company called PA, which we acquired, Professional Access. So when I first went to PA, and Sunil would bear me out, you know, I also thought, you know, they're essentially working for the retail sector. But they told me, no, we are a broader digital commerce company. So we are very much focusing on BFSI. We are focusing on manufacturing. So there's a big digital thrust which is happening in that sector. For example, in Bangalore, there is a company which is, so what they have done is they have covered the entire small and medium sector companies and factories. And they've said, look, you don't need to have a supply chain or a stores function anymore. So we will provide you stock on demand, products on demand, raw materials on demand. So it's an e-commerce application for small and medium sector. So overnight, none of them need to keep a physical store. None of them need to keep store manager. They used to have supply chain manager, materials manager. All those positions are gone. And they're guaranteeing delivery in 48 hours. So therefore, your stock on demand, you need to keep, all the big old concepts that we all learned in the early days are actually coming true. So there is huge amount of innovation happening in that sector. There is an Uber for trucks now. I don't know whether you know. There's a company which started Uber for trucks. And they're saying, don't get into these big logistical arrangements with all these trucking companies and all that. We'll supply you. And they're saying you can actually go online and click on whether you want an LCV, whether you want 3-tonner, you want 10-tonner. It's already available. It's being used. you have a question. Maybe another mic.
So my question is related to the future trends that in the upcoming time period, do you think that generally companies do surveys to create new startups or new entrants in the market? So in upcoming future, which are those sectors which can create, generate more incomes and vacancies and also creates employment according to you?
That's a tough one. I mean, you should be asking an economist that question, but it's very difficult to say because, you know, it's obviously, I think services companies are going to be providing more employment opportunity. It's just from a headcount point of view. But again, don't take that for granted. You know, the days of you seeing, for example, IT services companies like, you know, 300,000, 400,000, it won't grow at that pace. You're already seeing the impact of robotics and automation on headcount. But you will probably see, if entrepreneurship picks up, you will see far more industries coming up which are smaller. And when I say industry, I mean broadly. I don't mean just manufacturing. I mean sectors, areas, business areas which will mushroom. And jobs which didn't even exist before will start appearing. And if rural penetration happens, so if you just drive through rural India, it's empty. I mean, all of us, when you drive out of our cities, there is nothing. There are very few states, there are a few industrial states in this country like Maharashtra, Gujarat, Tamil Nadu, which have got at least Haryana, Punjab, which have got at least satellite towns which are having industries. But the vast space, which is the big Bharat, is empty. So how will you, so this whole migration which is coming into cities, which is putting a strain, we've got to find a solution to it. We have to reverse it. So when you see employment opportunities springing up in these places, and they become self-sustaining, that will create opportunities. But I know your question is not coming from that. You're asking a more specific question about what happens to people like us, what happens to campuses, where do they go into. I think we will see maybe 1 or 2 years of strain yet in the economy because the global economy is strained. It's not going to be easy for the next 1 or 2 years. But there are going to be, for example, we are seeing already in RPG, we have a water business. Now, nobody is focusing on water. They are saying it is the most precious commodity already in the earth. It will get more and more precious. The water treatment and the water resources management industry is huge. You know, for example, we have a business called water resources management, where we are building canals, we are building dams, and at one stage, when we got very excited when the interlinking of rivers project was promised, 125,000 crores of investment will come into this country. So even if we got 2,000 kilometers of linking, enormous employment generation would have happened. So I'm deliberately answering your question at a broad macroeconomic level. Very difficult for me to predict which sectors will generate. People are definitely saying that services sector will continue to grow. And the services can happen in multiple ways. It could be hospitality industry. Healthcare is growing. Healthcare has proven to be the most recession-proof industry ever. And at one stage, I used to work for the Apollo Hospitals Group, and I was amazed to see that their revenues year on year kept on growing, you know, because that industry will never slow down. So that will absorb a lot of people. I think you will see slowdown in sectors like telecom, because a lot of the infrastructure has moved into the towers companies, and these are pure services companies, and they're a little bit struggling with, you know, tele density having reached 110-120% in most urban areas. So it'll be interesting times, but very, very, it could be you know, next 2 years can kill a lot of industries also. You can see that happening.
This was the last question.
Thank you, sir. The insights that you have provided us with will help us in preparing better for our entry into the corporate world. As you rightly said, we need to be innovative, ambitious, and at the same time, focused on being a long-term player to survive and achieve in this greater VUCA environment that the corporate is moving towards. May I request Professor B. Parmanandan, Director of Finance, Sri Balaji Society, to present our guest with a memento as a token of love and appreciation.
Thank you.